In the previous segment, we examined how, without any foreknowledge and without any additional cues, it is impossible to determine one's sexuality simply by looking at his or her natural physical characteristics. The hands, feet, eyes, noses, even genitalia of non-straight persons are equally as indistinguishable from the identical features of persons of normal sexuality. But there are many people who will readily make the declaration, often quite emphatically, that they can accurately identify a person as a homosexual based simply on how that person talks, based on such indicators as pitch, cadence, inflection, and/or the presence of a hard or noticeable lisp. So again, let's try an experiment similar to the one we just conducted with the visual images, only this time examining the patterns and qualities of individual speech, again as its own entity, without the aid of any additional cues. What now follows is a collection of voices of both men and women who are well-known figures in the career fields of business, athletics, politics, and/or entertainment. And as before, your job is very simple. Again, accurately identify those voices which belong to the out-and-open homosexual from among the mix. An even number of male and female voices will be played back, in no particular order, for scrutiny. At least one of the voices in each gender group will belong to a well-known and confirmed homosexual. It could be just a single voice in each group, it could be a couple, it could be half, it could be all but one. The only thing to understand from the start is that this is not being presented as a trick question where every voice you hear will belong exclusively to one category or the other. So with all of that explanatory exposition out of the way, let's begin.
She insisted on staying at my house one weekend, and first of all, she wanted to go out the night before I was there. So if she ever asked to go to your house alone, never allow her to be in your house alone. So I sent her a key, and she gets out there, and I get these tweets from her, and I keep looking down, and they are naked photos of her that she is tweeting. And not just, like, naked, you know, out of the shower, like, her sprawled on the couch. And, I mean, I had to get, like, a cleaning crew with a wet vac.
Lisa hadn't done that well, and, you know, some people were saying, okay, that general approach wasn't good. But the team that Steve built, even within the company, to pursue that, even some days it felt a little ahead of its time. I don't remember that.
They didn't have to come. The doctor there made them come because I didn't bring my doctor there with me. So people a lot of times think because you're a celebrity that you're taken care of more. In some situations, people, you're not, you get it worse.
And they didn't know, and it was a big disaster, and they threatened to pull him out of school, and they were, you know, really angry, and he called me. I had a radio show then, and he called me, and I got him off the air and got his mother's phone number and called my mother and gave my mother Jake's mother's phone number and had my mom call his mom and yell at her, and it helped. But yeah, I gave him some really shitty advice, and that is really shitty advice. There's a lot of bad advice.
It's not. I mean, they do claim that the movie is based on facts in the 9/11 Commission report. So when you go to the 9/11 Commission report and try to check some of the scenes, you find in many cases that the 9/11 Commission report says the opposite.
And it was startling. And I met a woman who was a teacher, a high school teacher. And then I said, can you sleep with your students? And she said, yeah, but they have to be 17. And you have to report the relationship to the school administration. Now, I just meant that as a joke.
You know, it's kind of a volume business, so there's always something else that's going to take its place. I don't think anything really lasts in anyone's memory anyway, except, you know, certain key things, like you asking Sarah Palin what newspaper she reads. People, you know, hold on to certain brilliant things. That was fantastic.
And what that might do to me on a health level could be really, like, dangerous. So that's probably the real reason I wouldn't. You know, taking care of my health and keeping my weight a certain is really very much part of, you know, taking care of myself and being healthy. And because I'm a mom now, like, I wouldn't take risks like that.
It's if you think about the odds that you're against, it's such a crazy job because we have everything going against us. You know, like our message is repetitive. It goes on forever. We're asking people for money, which nobody likes. And if we fail, people lose their jobs. It's like it's everything bad combined all at once. And so,
you know, strangely enough, I mean, I sometimes think of my life as having been very rarefied and very protected. My mom, you know, I went to a strict school. I wore a uniform. I had a very close relationship with my mother. But she didn't keep information from me. She would take me to see, you know, Bertolucci movies. And I think that was good. I think I had an understanding of human behavior. And I don't think it's made me a loony.
We saw approximately 300 to 400 domestic abuse cases a year that came to court as actual cases. And what I found there was that the judicial response to domestic violence was so limited and it didn't take care of so much of the breadth of the problem. They would come in and by the time everybody was in there, the court was the problem and no longer the abuser.
John Huntsman, I don't know if he was ever going to be serious. I think he was trying to buy for the media darling role because the right-wing grassroots, they were never going to embrace him. I mean, this guy was in the Obama administration. He believes in global warming. So, of course, what this shows is that Republicans don't really believe all that rhetoric about being tough on terrorism and whatnot. If they can make a buck off that stuff, they'll make a buck. But, of course, this gives ammunition to his opponents. Not sure they need it, that much ammunition, but it does make his tough slog pretty much an impossible one.
Well, the whole situation, I think, is a little bit bigger than the performers themselves. When I reflect on it, looking back at 9-1-1, you see that we were sort of galvanized to come together and do something. And our so-called leaders told us to go back to the malls and spend money. I think all of us are pretty much searching for just clarity and some sort of order in our lives now.
There's no way to do it shorter. I needed to lay this out in a way that showed the evidence as I saw it and made this case, and I needed to do it in a long-form way. So I do not like writing. I write all day, but I write for, you know, script. In terms of writing for the eye, it makes me want to die. But I wanted to get this case made. I wanted to make this point, and I did it. Like, it is what I wanted it to be.
And a guy like Singer comes and says, oh, I'll buy that distressed mortgage, or I'll buy that house that's in foreclosure. He buys the loan of the Congo for pennies on the dollar and then goes to court and says, I hold the loan to this country, or I own the loan to your house, and I want to be paid the full amount of the loan. Right. And the court's been ruling in their favor, saying, yes, Congo, you almost got to foreclosure. You almost got there, but this guy came, and for pennies on the dollar, he bought you bad debt, and now you have to pay him the full amount of the loan you took, plus interest.
Everything's physical for me. Everything is being fit and being in shape, and for so many years not to feel at my top at all, it was tough. And just more of a relief, like, okay, now I know what I'm dealing with. Now I have an opportunity to feel better. So I think the best thing that could have happened for me this summer was actually to feel worse, so I could get better.
So what's the verdict? Which voices were the dead giveaway which tagged its speakers as the homosexual men and women from among the crowd? In the meantime, the next several chapters will examine in some detail the most heavily promoted scientific theories being held up as supposed confirmation that non-straight sexuality is predetermined either from the moment of conception, i.e. genetically, or sometime during the pre-birth developmental stage, i.e. hormonally. We will be considering the genetic, biological, and medical studies and observations which have been appealed to by GLBT defenders and advocates as their quote-unquote proof that non-straight sexuality is anything other than a partially physical but mostly psychological affliction.